here. I'm the Director of Planning and Resilience at Scape Landscape Architecture. We're a landscape architecture office, design of largely in the public realm. We really work on the interface and edge of engineering and design. My colleagues, Alan Estivier from WSP, who is the head of Water Resources Group and Northeast Resiliency Lead for Transportation and Infrastructure, and Paul Cherkey with Arcadis, who's an Associate Vice President and for Coastal Protection, Resiliency, and Restoration. And the reason I've asked them here today is we really try to incorporate science and science-driven data in our design work. And I've had the I don't want to say good fortune, but I have actually been deeply involved in a lot of the resilience planning and design that's happened in New York City and New York State in the wake of some of our of Hurricane Sandy and some of the other storm events that we've had. And I think it's really important that we begin to unpack that box of what's really driving risk and resilience as we work. And what I've learned over the time is these are really complex processes, actually, and we need to learn how to work as designers and data visualizers with the experts that are developing this information. But I also think about how we start to, how we can engage you guys to unpack that box a little bit. And can I take a moment for a show of hands? How many folks here are data scientists, or would define themselves? Okay. How many people are designers, architecture, landscape architecture, graphic design? Government? Okay. Engineers? Okay, so we've got a mix. And there's some group that I didn't manage to ask about too, because there's a lot of people who didn't raise their hand. But what we hope to do today is unpack and convey some of the mechanisms and processes that define risk. We're specifically going to talk about inland flooding and some of our dynamic coastal risks. I know there's a lot of risks associated with climate change, but it is a big topic to unpack, so we're going to focus a little bit. But what I also hope to do is to illustrate and show a little bit about how that information is being used in design and help us to iteratively test our ideas and determine their effectiveness, but also how we begin to communicate that information back out to people and engage people in the process. So that's us. One of the things that we know is we know our climate is changing, right? It's very uncertain in the future. We don't exactly know how much, but the trends are very, very, very clear. And we've done a really good job, actually, of convincing people that that's happening, despite some very high-profile detractors. The majority of people believe that climate change is happening and that it will cause harm. However, when we ask people a similar question, will it harm me? Will it affect my life? You get a very different answer. People think it's something that's happening somewhere else. But we know that this is not actually true, right? We know there are really strong economic impacts. But what we've found is that it's only when something like this happens. This is some pictures very recently from the news, Hurricane Harvey, right? We can talk all we want about the impacts of the collision of coastal and inland flooding, and then we see it, right? And, you know, this has things happen that shouldn't happen, right? The collision of inland flooding, coastal flooding, and our development plans, this is an evacuation center that flooded. You know, this is the sort of property damage. And it wasn't a lack of information that led to this. If none of you have read it, there was a ProPublica article in 2016, that's what an excerpt of this is, and it says, what if Hurricane Ike, which hit and had devastating effects in Galveston in 2008, had tracked a little to the west, and what would have happened in Houston? They basically described what happened in Harvey. But we need to connect. You know, we had this experience here in New York. And for most of you, if you're from the region, I'll spare you the photos. We've lived through that. But, you know, it starts to say, how can we do better as we build back from these disasters and try to talk about climate change? How can we use those experiences to leverage things better? And a lot of the investment that happened after Hurricane Sandy, both at the federal, state, and city level, had to do with building back better, building back more resiliently, coming back in a way that allows us to adapt and move in the future to these changes. And so what does that mean for how we deliver projects? And how we develop projects. We look at things generally in a very linear process. We collect the data, we design and engineer, we implement them, we maintain them. But you know, what we've started to do is really open up that range of data collection, and that's probably a lot of what you guys have been involved in, really expanding both the types of physical analysis that we do and environmental data that we gather, but also how we engage people and gather human data. And that's really important for how we communicate the results. But this is what I'm really more interested at in design and engaging the data visualization and data scientist community in, and I think you'll hear from engineers today, in that how we use data and how we use modeling to iteratively test our designs. How do they work? Really start that conversation through the design process and engage people in understanding what happens. So we're going to talk briefly about two projects. Alan's going to speak first about this project in upstate New York that has more to do with coast inland flooding, and Paul is going to talk about the Living Breakwaters project on Staten Island. And both of these projects came out of initiatives following Sandy, the first from the New York Governor's Office of Storm Recovery, New York Rising Rebuilding Reconstruction Program, and the second from the HUD Rebuild by Design competition. And I've had the fortune of working with both these engineers on this. So Alan.
Thank you, Pippa. Good morning. So the first project we will showcase is an inland resiliency project that we recently completed, actually, Pippa and myself, in association with a larger team. And we tried to, you know, to assist our clients here. There were several municipalities, actually, in the Hudson River watershed in Orange County, New York, to find solution for their recurrent flooding, you know, the repetitive flooding that they were going through. They had devastating effect during Hurricane Irene. They had hundreds of houses that were devastated and destroyed. They had like several bridges that were washed away, and the emergency service couldn't respond. They were themselves flooded, which we really needed to find some solution here. So we found a drastic shift in the way like politicians were handling like adaptation prior to Hurricane Irene and Sandy. We didn't talk about resilience. We didn't talk much about climate change. And then we saw a drastic change. And after 2013, we really starting hearing more and more about resiliency and how we can help the communities to rebuild stronger and more resilient infrastructure that can be adapted to the climate risk. New York, under the leadership of Andrew Cuomo, have been extremely proactive in trying to adapt. In 2015, the Community Risk and Resiliency Act was adopted. And it consists of using, actually, you know, now the public agencies and municipalities in New York State need to understand their and to take into account their climate risk when they plan and design new infrastructure. And there are a few state agencies, including New York State DEC and NYSERDA and other panels that really try to gather a climate risk data and for the practitioner to better plan our infrastructure in the future. So the project I will talk about is part of one of this program, which is called the New York Rising Program, launched in 2013. This program meant to help like over 120 communities that were severely impacted during Hurricane Irene and Sandy to rebuild stronger and more resilience, to help the community to adapt. So $700 million were spent by the state, mostly through federal funding, to implement those projects. So the overall approach that we took for this project were really to start by doing extensive flood modeling, understanding the current and future risk condition. And then we look at assessing the risk. So we looked at the vulnerabilities of those different towns in the watershed. And then we overlap both the physical risk and the physical hazard, the flooding hazard, and the vulnerability to really understand where the issue were and where the risk were. And using that, we develop different projects to mitigate flooding and help the town to incorporate those projects into their capital planning. And throughout the whole process, we use a lot of data. So in the engineering and design world, we have a tremendous amount of data available, and we see for all the phases of our project, we use like a lot of different type of data, including elevation, land use, land cover, soil type, and asset data, and so on to best understand the risk in the area. So one of the main challenges that we face as engineers is to select the data. How can we select the best data to serve our client needs? So, we try to select the best and most accurate data, but we also working in a local regulatory framework where in order for a project to be built, we need to obtain permits in order for to go to construction. And those permits, sometimes in order to obtain certain permits, like the agencies want us to use certain type of data. And there is a certain inertia between the research where like the data become available, the best data that we use, versus the adoption and the implementation by the different permitting agencies. So we need as engineers to balance the client's interest and using the best data versus making sure that those projects can be built. So, the modeling that we perform in order to understand the flooding risk was based, we use basically different components, hydrologic modeling, stormwater modeling, and riverine modeling. And here we see like the importance of data. Typically for hydrologic modeling, to understand the flooding risk, we need to understand the precipitation, infiltration, runoff processes throughout a watershed. Like 15 years ago, we didn't have very good data, and now with remote sensing technology, we have really improved the quality of the data available to perform a hydrologic analysis. Now we have continuous coverage of typically land use, land cover, and soil data that are paramount to really accurately model the infiltration runoff processes that ultimately will lead to flooding. So that's applied also for riverine flooding. We see that within 6 years, like we now have a terrain that are digital elevation model that are way more accurate. Like for the watershed we were actually working on, we had 500 million data points for the terrain. So we see that now it's extremely accurate. Before, like even 5 years ago, 6 years ago, we were working with data that were way more coarse. So when we perform flood modeling, we can definitely obtain better results with the data that that we have today. So ultimately, this is a short video that shows the use of this data to understand the risk. So those are projected flooding risk for the 100-year flood. So the first scenario is actually today risk, and then we use all the selected data to understand the risk like in the future, so in 2050, and then further down the road in 2070. So the understanding of the risk is critical to develop the best mitigation measure to resolve or mitigate the flooding risk for our clients. And based on this understanding of the risk, we developed different flood mitigation projects. Some of them were like hard infrastructure where we enlarge like bridges, we remove dams to let the water without barriers. And we also look at policies and planning project where we actually integrated the resiliency component into planning, into the comprehensive plan and the zoning of those communities to help them to recover. And I think Pipa will say a couple of words about
And so why does this matter for planning and design? I think one of the key things was that this flood model that Alan showed us enabled people to begin to understand the mechanism through which these projects actually reduced flooding, whether it was to store and delay the water, whether it was to let water move throughly and not back up and flood. And so Alan, if you flip to the next one, what you see is that dashed box is the area that Alan showed you the model of. That's where most homes were damaged. And when we started this project, the politicians, the local communities, they wanted to like open up a park there to capture water. That really wouldn't have done that much, but it was very hard to communicate that to them. At the end of this process, and each of these municipalities, and any of you who are in government who've worked in municipal with individual municipalities, the town leaders in that actually decided to spend their money outside of their municipality, upstream, because this model was able to illustrate that they could achieve the best flood risk reduction by investing elsewhere. And that was able, and they were able to get buy-in on that at the community meetings because this was able to be shared. And so I think these are some of the opportunities for design. So I'm gonna turn it over to Paul to talk about a very different project on the coast.
Okay, so following on our conversation here about using data for resilience and how we apply that data. So this is a coastal risk reduction project, resiliency project. And so one of the things that occurs to me that is kind of a theme that goes through all of this is that in our case, what's different about how we're handling data is we're taking data in, we're doing some modeling or engineering or design, and then we got to take that data out and then use it for something that's implementable and be able to communicate that data. So from a science perspective, we get all this raw environmental data that then we have to process through our engineering and design, and then that process data then has to be communicated effectively to the stakeholders. So you have all those same data challenges that we keep talking about, you know, large amounts of data, how do we check the quality of that data, how do we, you know, store and house that data and use that data. And so the more data you get, like Alan shows, we have much more detail now for terrain and topography. Well, that creates a benefit and a challenge, right, of how to handle that amounts of data. So if we look at this, you know, from that perspective, leading to the modeling. So from a lot of engineering and design we do modeling to predict then these future consequences of what we might do or the impacts or benefits of the projects that we're trying to do to improve resilience. So we have a lot of data that comes in of varying temporal scales, of varying spatial scales, and you know it's important for us to then be able to assess that data and that reliability. And then we have the model, which then also pushes out a lot of data of varying sizes and amounts, and then that data we need to then be able to communicate and implement and use that data then to build a resilient project. So if we look at Living Breakwaters, which is the project I'm specifically going to talk about today, this is a green coastal infrastructure innovative kind of project that was selected out of the Rebuild by Design competition for HUD funding. And it's a series of offshore ecological breakwaters with the goal of improving resiliency of the Tottenville area of the Staten Island shoreline. And you can see here there's three different types of breakwaters, even in different shapes and orientations. And that's part of what the data and modeling helped us get to, is that for different purposes along the shoreline where we wanted to attenuate waves, protect infrastructure, or hold the beach, or block the main storm directions, we were able then to alter these locations and parameters of design on the breakwaters. So really the project has, as part of the resilient infrastructure, has three components that we thought about. You know, not only kind of the risk reduction structural breakwater component, which looked at storm waves and erosion, but also the ecological enhancement and social resiliency. So sort of tying all these three things together at the start of design as an integrated piece, and not just saying, well, we're gonna build a breakwater and then let's tag on some ecological features, let's see how it impacts the community. So to think in resilient design, we gotta take all that data in at the start and really integrate those parts from the beginning. So if we look, here's some of the data challenges right off the start, right, is how do we have a structure that's sound, how do we incorporate good ecological practice to improve that, and then how do we choose our data too, right? Sea level rise is a big challenge. There's a lot of data out there, so we have to select then reasonable amounts of sea level rise or bracket ranges of which to look at into the future. So again, large amounts of data. We got data coming in and data coming out once we model and process it. And then how do we got to retrieve, compile, analyze, and communicate that data. So here's sort of the main data flow of the project, right? So we have that environmental data again, going through to what are the environmental impacts. So additional conditions we have to bring in, which are all those environmental parameters, waves, water levels, the bathymetry, the sediment properties. And then we have to use that data in a decision-making process. And here what we did was we did a lot of conceptual models. So we actually chose to do simpler modeling than we could have done so that we could look at a lot more what-if scenarios to help develop then a solution that we wanted to advance then through the engineering, and then that gives us the design information and then to final design. And then again, the challenge is we have different data of different forms, so we want to be able to communicate that data then to the stakeholders and the public at the end. So here, So one example is risk. So where do the waves come was the very first question. So we're talking about risk of trying to build breakwaters that attenuate waves. Where are those waves coming from? So what we found was there wasn't a lot of wave data, very little measured data. So this is one of our challenges often in these coastal projects is there's not a long history of data in a lot of places. So we have a deficiency of data. So we had a lot of wave data offshore, though, from Army Corps studies and sort of their modeling. And so we had 30 years of wave data offshore, but we needed it inshore. So what we looked at is, OK, let's model that data coming inshore. Let's add the effects of local winds. Let's create that data. So this was a huge data set again, where you have 30 years worth of hourly wave data. And in the past, we would have had to parse that up and find ways to approximate things. But now, with supercomputers, we were able to run all 30 years in hourly segments, transform the waves through our model from offshore to onshore. And so that gave us the wave information then that would help us drive the decision making of, you know, where do we need protection from? Where are the storm waves coming from? How can we attenuate them? How can we place these breakwaters in a way that then enhances the shoreline and also provides ecological benefit? So I don't want to get too far into the weeds other than to say, you know, this is back following with this risk change wave attenuation. So if you think of wave attenuation in a simple way, right? You have a big wave, it hits the breakwaters, and it's a little wave on the other side. But now, so we had to look at sort of the no action and with action. And so red's bad, big waves as before, and blue gets better to where the waves get smaller. So this is one of the modeling things we had to do. And so this is a challenge then of how to display this data, how to process that data so that we have it that's understandable not only for the engineering and analysis, but ultimately to the stakeholders, the public, the agencies, so that they can understand the benefit of what we're trying to do. And so here, another piece of this was then understanding our shoreline erosion reduction, so the physical change. So here we had, again, a couple different data sets. We had aerial photography, historical aerial photography that we did GIS analysis on to see how the shoreline was changing historically. And then we modeled that, and so that gave us verification that our model was behaving correctly to this historical pattern. And then we can do that leap of faith, that what-if scenario of modeling, where now we move to the next stage and we model and say, okay, if we put these structures like this, how does our shoreline change? And finally, you know, ecological change. So how do we create a diverse, sustainable habitat? And so this was really interesting because one of the questions that was really important ecologically, especially to oysters, is in these reef structures, these reef streets that we were proposing in these breakwaters, which are quite unique. The concern was, well, how does sedimentation happen there? Because the oysters, quite simply, don't want to get buried in sediment, right? So they're not happy like that. So how do we create diverse, complex habitat and make sure that it's behaving as we expect with flows and sediment motion? So this is, you know, some modeling that we did was very complex, three-dimensional fluid dynamic modeling. You can see here's a data visualization issue too, right? So this complex data that was good for analysis also we can then help visualize. And here, for example, this model here of one of these single living breakwaters was in the range of 2.5 million grid cells. So that's a lot of data points and a lot of data handle. And then how do you better visualize that both for making design decisions and then to communicate what you're doing to the end user. So another one was, not only do we want to look at our changes, but how do we avoid changes? So one of the things that question that was asked is, if you put all these breakwaters in front of the shore, what impact do you have on water quality? And so this just shows before and after. You can see very little difference between the two, which was the intent. That's a good thing. And this was looking at how that water would move behind. So this is just looking at the motion of those particles of water as they move over time and how the effect of the structures would change that. So finally, you know, looking at our resilience data challenges. So we have large amounts of data of varying types and temporal and spatial scales. So the first thing is to sort that data and use it effectively that it can be input into modeling. And then ultimately, that large amount of data that comes out of the modeling, how then do we transmit and visualize that data? And then we have political noise. So we're talking about sea level rise, climate change here. There's a ton of political noise around that. So if we can look at the data, we need to really make sure that we can drive the decision making from the data and not from the political noise. And having the data helps to clear some of that political noise. And then how do we convey that data, right? So how do we make it usable for both our analysis and modeling, that incoming data? And then how do we convey that data on the outcoming side so that it's easy to visualize and you visualize it appropriately depending on the audience? So when you're looking at that data, when we're doing a design meeting with a bunch of engineers and designers in a room, we might look at that data completely differently than we're doing a stakeholder or agency meeting. Same data set, just different ways of visualizing it, depending on the audience and what they were concerned about in the end. And then the last thing then, I guess, is, you know, is we can improve our resiliency solutions
if we, you know, smartly manage that data, and if we model that data and then bracket possible solutions with that data. And one of the things that really came out of this project was the importance of not necessarily getting always carried away with using the most data you have, but sometimes using a smaller set of that data and really using a simpler model and doing a lot of what-if scenarios that help then drive you to the solution that looks the best, and then you can bring in more data and more complex modeling. I think we have a final video here. Pippa,
yeah.
Do you want to speak to that?
So this is Paul had talked about the shoreline change modeling that we did, how the breakwaters would impact erosion, and it's kind of a complex process. So we put together this video with the help of Nans, who's in the back of the room, and the data that that Paul put together to try to communicate and illustrate this process. Because it was relatively simple for people to understand that waves would hit the breakwaters and they would get attenuated, but that they would affect the way sediment moved along the shoreline and literally grow it back was much harder to convey. But so we'll let this run. But I think one of the key things here in design that you've heard is if you're a little confused by all this, that's good. These are really complex processes, you know, climate change, coastal risk, inland flooding. But we do have the data and tools to start to unpack them and start a dialogue about it and be open to having that dialogue throughout the design process. So as you'll see in a moment, we can iteratively test. So these first scenarios that we did were kind of like calibration tests to say, what's going to happen if we spread breakwaters evenly across the coastline? What's going to happen if we scrunch them all together? And does that reflect what our perceptions would be? And so, you know, one of the key things that these models help is to help the engineers sort of calibrate how the models are working to the actual conditions, but also in communicating to the public, help us as designers and planners help calibrate what we're doing to the community's perception. Does when we run this model reflect what I experienced when this event happened? And what we see as we started talking about erosion, even during the competition phase in this project, is people be like, oh yeah, when I was a kid, my beach was like 60 feet wide, and now it's only 10 feet. That makes sense. And so I think that you know, this visualization is a part of the conversation too. So yeah, we'll let the model run, and you'll see, as Paul said, this was the simpler model, and it allowed us to test lots of iterations. And as you'll see, a lot of them didn't work very well. The red is erosion, the blue is accretion. We're trying to build beach back, right? If we'd gone with our first idea and just kind of went on that linear path, we wouldn't necessarily be in a very good place for solving the erosion problem on the shoreline. It really took a lot of iterative steps and actions to get to where we are now and can move forward.
And what's interesting, I think, about this video and some of these visualizations, too, is from the engineer's perspective, they're usually just as happy with a data table, a spreadsheet, graphs, make decisions on what's performing better or worse. But when we got to these visualizations, it really opened up people's thinking, right? So they started to think outside of the box, because even though the numbers showed this and the graph showed that, actually seeing it helped people think, oh, well, what if we tweak that? What if we can rotate something, you know? So it actually, having these visualizations, even though we always talk about them as kind of the end product from the engineer kind of thing to help other people visualize, they're actually also helpful in the design and engineering process to push the engineer sometimes to think out of the box, that they get lost in the linear data, and this makes them think a little bit outside the box. So it's a neat sort of side spin-off from that.
I think for both of these projects, that interim phase, and I think we do think about data visualization as an end communication phase, and I really want to push everyone to think about how is it as an engagement tool, an iterative process to enable communication? And what we found is these resilience projects are going to take large interdisciplinary teams with people from a really diverse set of backgrounds. And we speak different languages. We may all speak English, but when we come from different disciplines, like planners don't talk designer, and engineers don't necessarily talk designer, and designers don't necessarily talk engineers. And we can be talking around each other and really, you know, be looking at very different things. So these trying to represent data in multiple ways really helps us ensure that we're actually having the same conversation. So I'll open it up to questions.
Thank you. I really enjoyed that. So I'm coming to this talk as an engineer. I'm kind of struck by the range of all the consequences you consider in your models, like down to the habitats of oysters. And so I'm curious, as a planner, how do you approach the possibility of like unexpected consequences or unknown unknowns in your process?
Two things on that. I think one, and this is why I think a lot of traditional, even flood management and coastal engineering projects were very single purpose. And one of the things we've been talking about now is how do we do multi-purpose projects, right? How do we do projects that have provide multiple benefits for the community and avoid potential harm? And I think the first step is, one, really articulating those goals. And I think for engineers, really working with planners to say, what are all the objectives in the community? And maybe you might prioritize a few. So with the Living Breakwaters project, the priority was, these three top priorities. In the blooming of coastal risk reduction, specifically waves and erosion, ecological enhancement, creating reef habitat, and social resilience, which we didn't talk about a lot today, but had a lot to do with engagement of students and monitoring of the project that's ongoing. So that science aspect was actually part of that. But there's this sort of do no harm. So part of what came out of those conversations with the community was, what are you worried about? And really listening to the regulators in the community, right? And what we heard was, from the Army Corps, we're worried about sediment going into our channel. From the neighborhood, we're worried about trash and water quality going down if it gets trapped behind the breakwaters. And Paul said, well, that's not really an issue in the breakwater, like with breakwater projects. But I'm like, but the perception is that it is here. And so that water circulation model, the last of the three that he showed, it looks at circulation and flushing and says, when I put the breakwaters in, it's no different than when they're not there. So there might be questions that you're trying to answer for the primary goals of your project, but listen to the questions that people are asking and have that conversation in your team about, okay, how can we clear that question up? And I think this was in Blooming Grove, there was a really similar process, but maybe with different, different things. I think what we found as the community prioritized project or the engineers prioritized projects for flood risk reduction, Alan, you started having conversations with like state agencies, and say DEC said, oh, that dam removal that's going to solve flooding is actually a priority for us from our stream connectivity and water quality benefits. And so that confluence, just looking for those correlations.
I have a question about something that I think Evan said. You mentioned not being able to use necessarily the best data in all cases because government agencies have certain requirements about what data can be used. Can you talk a little bit more about how you understood what those constraints were and why those stipulations are in place?
Yeah, I mean, I believe, first of all, like the regulatory agencies, they have a pretty heavy like quality control and quality assurance process in place. So when the best and latest data becomes available, like it may sometimes take 2 years actually to for them to run through all those data, to vet those data, to validate them and to put them in the market. And then there's also, I think there's a lack of training. Maybe now what we see happening, we see those data, like we have more and more data coming, in a very, very, very quick frequency compared to before. So I think the public agency, they're trying to respond to that, and the decision maker as well, are usually older and maybe not, and they're not used to this frequency, this amount of data and things like that. So I think they really try to adapt, and it takes longer than in private private corporation, even though we have our own challenge on our side too. But this is definitely sometimes an issue because it doesn't serve best the project needs. In order to have a project constructed, we need to use sometimes certain type of data that we would not necessarily use because we know there are best data available. But if we want the project permitted and constructed, we need to balance the interest there. Mm-hmm.
And I think, Paul, this almost extends to some of the models that we use for the data too, right? In terms of what models agencies like the Army Corps want to see us use in analyzing it.
Yeah, and I think that you always have that challenge that there's certain accepted models by the Army Corps or by FEMA, so your end agencies have certain things that they're used to seeing and ways that they're used to seeing things displayed. So you have to be cognizant of that as well, even if there might be a better approach or better toy, if you will, better model or better data to display, that you still have to be cognizant that there's some restriction often on the larger government agencies of what they're used to seeing, and make sure that you still frame your answer that keeps at least that piece of it in.
And maybe to add to that, I think that, I mean, the big switch that we are seeing, you know, is that like the change in paradigm in engineering, where we really now try to plan for the future, you know. And even FEMA, which is running the National Flood Insurance Program, right now the FEMA maps that are available for, you know, for insurance purposes and so on, and you know, they're based on existing actually flood risk, and now what we try to do on those projects is to plan for the future, because the project that we build today, where, you know, the any type of large infrastructure project, we need to make sure that those projects will be resilient and will not be destroyed like 2 years down the road. So this is something that is very interesting that we see happening in our industry, where, you know, we need now to think forward and to develop design that is pretty much purely risk-based, so relying on much more data, and
Hi. Hello. Okay. I'm wondering, with the work that you're doing, if you share this information with insurance companies who are providing flood insurance, and two, how does that influence cost? And then three, how does that influence voluntary relocation of residents who are living along those flood prone areas?
That's a big question. I mean, I think that at the project level, one of the big hurdles out there is you get sort of higher level data, and chime in if you guys have thoughts on here, but the feedback loop doesn't necessarily happen from individual projects to the larger regional extent with insurance companies, because those models, those maps have to work for a broader area. I think it's also, it's also very politically difficult, right? I think exist in an environment in New York and other places where we want to talk about being resilient, but it's very hard to talk about things. The word retreat is like a four-letter word, right? And that may be the results and outcomes. So I think one of the things is actually at the local level, and this goes back to some of the, you know, the presentation that I was talking to the first time, is how do we just get that information from these individual projects, maybe right back out into the community, and let them make those risk evaluations themselves? Because it's going to take a lot longer for the government regulations and the insurance industry to kind of catch up with that. Because that's a very difficult and challenging battle to get these risks to sort of be correctly economically evaluated. And that's also not my area of expertise. So.
And I think also there's maybe a paradigm shift that has to happen there, which ties into the previous question, you know, that from a regulatory point of view, flood insurance is a good example. We look at a 100-year storm based on existing conditions. Where's that 100-year storm going to be? And so that's kind of the line in the sand thing that we've seen, you know, happen here, that we end up with these disasters and we have much more impact than we expect because we designed it for a specific event, right? And this is where Alan's talking about, you know, building the bigger risk picture into this in the beginning. And I think there's a shift with resiliency from sort of this flood protection prevention mentality that exists, you know, that we had a very much a protection. So let's build a wall, block a 100-year storm. But when that wall gets overtopped in that 100-year storm, it's the Katrina factor, right? That when that wall gets overtopped, it falls down. And now you have catastrophic failure. So are there ways you can build resiliency into your thinking so you shift your thinking from purely protecting against that one event to some kind of protection that remains in place towards an event that might be much worse than you anticipate? But that's kind of are you comfortable now getting your ankles wet occasionally? You know, yeah. And so there has to be a real shift, I think, in thinking. Resiliency is about, am I comfortable now getting my ankles wet occasionally instead of just blocking to a particular event? And sometimes it might mean I get wet to my knees, but I never drowned. You know, and I think that's the kind of thinking that has to change. And I don't know, it's not going to be a quick change. You know, it's a shift in thinking about how we even view the risk of these projects.
Speaking of paradigm shifts, resilience is often a priority after a major visible disaster. And I was wondering if you could speak to the role of data maybe in accessing funding for these projects.
Yeah, I think that because, and I also want to define resilience because I, you know, I'm working in this realm, but it's turning into the new sustainability, right? Where it's like, oh, it's resilient. That means everything. So when we talk about resilience, particularly in the context of flood risk, we mean the ability to recover, adapt, and thrive, actually, you know, not just get back, but actually sustain a reasonable quality of life in the face of chronic stresses like slowly rising temperatures or sea level, as well as sudden shocks, storm events, right? So that, you know, if Sandy were to happen again, we don't have power out for most of New Jersey for two weeks or a month. And so I think that data is really important to articulate to both the leadership, but I think in many ways the hard decisions are really difficult political decisions to make, and so that the nonprofits, the philanthropic organizations, and the community organizations that are electing those elected officials, getting that information out in a place-based way so that people make that connection to climate change impacting them, I think is a key first step. And this is my personal opinion, kind of a key first step in triggering that change. Because as you saw that map from the New York Times article, right, people believe it's happening, people believe it creates harm, but to someone else, not me. But people vote, people spend money on, you know, the way things affect them. I think one, very few at the local, even federal level, have taken initiatives, like resilient initiatives to adapt to climate change without having experienced a disaster. I think two of the initiatives that we're seeing right now that are changing that is the 100 Resilient Cities program that Rockefeller is funding, right? There's 100 cities around the world that are tackling this issue, whether or not they've actually experienced a disaster. We've also seen, we're at SCAPE in partnership with Arcadis, are part of one of the teams selected for the Resilient by Design Challenge in the Bay Area. And so the nine county region around San Francisco have actually initiated a process like Rebuild by Design to say, how are we going to adapt to rising sea levels and seismic risks in the future before they've had a disaster? They've said, look, it's not a matter of if, it's when, and we need to be thinking about this creatively. So they're kind of undertaking this process very proactively in a way we haven't necessarily seen. But often there's just not the political will until something, or the federal funding, until something bad has happened.
Yeah, because it is true that resiliency costs a lot of money. Typically, now we have tools and data that enable us to better understand the risk. But for instance, like New York State DEC, the Environmental Conservation Agency, they want all the dam owner in the state of New York to design for the 100-year flood. But now the problem is that, like, if we use those type of tools to very accurately, determining those 100-year flood, like 80% of the dam are not compliant to the regulation, and the state doesn't offer fundings. The dam owner, they just don't have the funding. So it's going to take time to adapt and to. I think it's really a new thinking in terms of planning and engineering that will take time because obviously those infrastructure are here right now and it takes time to switch. Yeah.
With Sandy, that's kind of your moment to get all this big funding, and the projects that you guys have used are these big, big, you know, you have one opportunity in your lifetime to do a mm-hmm. breakwater project. How have you seen applications using data and these similar tools to address kind of the day-to-day, full disclosure, I work for the Parks Department, so we deal with, yeah. I'm fortunate to be able to work on things like Rebuild by Design, but then we're also working with our maintenance staff and trying to communicate to them that, you know, you can't put this sort of electrical gearing underground because mm-hmm. you're in the floodplain.
Yeah. I mean, I think part of it is raising awareness about those things. And one of the tools that's not, you know, my expert, but I would charge all the economists out there to work on is life cycle costing. What you see, I mean, Paula, you did the research on the breakwaters. We were like looking, we were supposed to try to come up with some rough costs of what it takes to maintain breakwaters, you know, and the issues of the 13 that you looked at, the Army Corps had built, like only half of them had even been maintained in the last 50 years, that that these are, versus if you had a flood wall, it's, you know, it's a huge maintenance cost. And also the second part is monitoring, is actually, you know, investing now. Like, it's very hard to get maintenance and operations funding. It's very hard to get people to invest in monitoring these projects. But we hope that the sort of high profile of the living breakwaters and some of the inland flooding projects will attract academic and NGO organizations and investing in monitoring, because if we can illustrate that they, you know, this sort of benefit cost of these things, then that is the leverage that agencies like yours need to invest in these in the future, right? This is a big investment in the Living Breakwaters project for the governor's office right now off the south shore of Staten Island. But in monitoring that, can we identify, you know, how it works and reverses that erosion over time? And the benefit, you know, that may far outweigh the cost to sort of home damage and beach replenishment and other similarly exposed locations. And so I think those are some of the mechanisms we...
I think it begs, again, the point of changing thinking a little bit, right? So what you're talking about is kind of how do you deal with the nuisance, what I'll call nuisance flooding, the smaller events that cause the road to flood, and then you have these problems. And so we've been very good at thinking about 100-year storms and floodplains in that sense, but we haven't really thought about those little nuisance things, which now increase as your sea level rises, incidents of those sort of things are increasing. And I think that's a shift of, you don't have to always design the project to stop the superstorm, right? That there, mm-hmm. you can do smaller pieces of projects, layer projects, integrate them so that you can take care of some of these nuisance issues while at the same time building towards a larger solution.
Yeah. And we didn't talk about all the projects, I'll stop after this, but you know, that was one of the things that worked really well in the Blooming Grove project that Alan illustrated, where you know, one of the issues was just all of these locations where you were getting backup flooding. And they basically, this model allowed them to prioritize all the culverts in these two towns and sort of say, okay, these, you know, these two are really causing a lot of upstream flooding. Turned out, these were priorities where it's not that expensive to do, to enlarge a culvert or to take it out even. Some of these places were already priorities where DEC wanted to invest in stream connectivity, or where the state DOT already had money set aside to do these replacements, and it was just a matter of doing it right. So that kind of triangulation for those smaller scales are important. I think we're out of time. Scape also has a virtual reality station set up downstairs with some of our projects, including the Living Breakwaters project, if you want to explore what those look like from underwater. So. Thank you.